Okay, so then let's continue with program rules. Just a few comments on program rules. So so basically, we are using the, as probably most of you know, we are using the same program rules engine for between Android and web. So that means that it's the same code. We're trying always to have the same version as well as the web. But of course, this works as the logic part of the program rules. But then there is also the part where the program rules is executed, right? And then it's where the difference is. Like, for example, in the web, we are saying that the program rules is executing in the web browser, and here it's executing in an Android application. So there may be some discrepancies as well in the way that they may work in Android within web. And we have all the discrepancies is here, okay? So here, if you go to this document over here, so we have a lot of information. We are trying to keep updated this document all the time, right? So we have different sections, like the program rules supported in Android Capture App, the variables source type supported, program rule action supported. And then here there is a section at the bottom. Okay, here we go. So like the functions here as well, that I think is quite useful. Standard variables here, differences between the program rules in the web and Android version, okay? So normally when people are like, having issues with the program rules, normally our recommendation is like, please check first the documentation, okay? Because when we hear like, okay, this is working in the web, it's not working in Android, or it's the other way around. Sometimes it's working in the web, in Android, but maybe it has a different way of like displaying the changes in the web. So we are trying to have all the information here in this document. So please check this one out. We think it's very useful. So basically please test well in both environments, okay, with that document in front of you. So, but basically we are like supporting all the program rule variables. We are supporting almost all the program rule actions and all the functions. Okay, so the ones that are not being supported, well, is the send and schedule message, because so far, well, this is already working in the server side, so these program rules are executing in the server side, and we will see if in the future this makes sense or not to also have in Android or not. Okay, but so far it's just working in the server side. Also, we have this. Program rule actions, these are the ones that are like all these ones that are the supported by Android. So this one, display text key value pair, I believe that in the web, this is going to a widget. So it will show the results in the widget, but we don't have a widget in the Android application for this, okay? So the way that is working now is like, it will render the result in the bottom of your data entry form. Okay, so you open an event, it will, if this goes to the, it triggers this action, then it will show the result at the bottom of the form, of the data entry form. Okay, but yes, I think that our best recommendation is here is always please check the documentation, and then if you cannot find something or if something is not clear, yes, please ask us. So program indicators and legends. Also, as Marta was mentioning before, there is here in the application, we have in the TI dashboard, we have here you're going to see now a demo for this, but we have here like a tab to show the indicators. So what is important here to consider is the program indicators in this version, well, in this version and previous ones, are only supported in the domain of the track identity instances. Okay, so if you have a program indicator that counts different, I don't know, events or TIs, and the event belongs to different enrollments of different TIs, so that is not going to work here, okay? So the domain, it's again, the track identity instances. We're going to change this in the next Android versions because we had like many requirements from the community asking for more, having more powerful analytics in the app. Okay, so we are going to provide this functionality in the coming versions into 4, into 5, and probably into 6. It's going to be like a progressive work, but definitely it's going to be there. Okay, so Okay, so as I said, this is something that then this needs to happen in the at the tracked MPP instance level. So the way that we have in the server side in order to have that is just marking this option here, display inform. Okay, so this is important. Okay, if you would like to for the program indicator to appear in the in this tab, so you have to you need to have this marked. Okay. Then legends is also working, so you can have, you know, that you can have a legend set like linked to a program indicator. It will also show in the app as well. Okay, it's not a problem. There are no limitations of this. And then what is available and what is not available? And again, for this version, because in the next version is going to be we're going to have more power in the analytics. But for now, aggregation types, you don't need to pay attention to aggregation types because our analytics right now is only making sense in the enrollment level, at the TI enrollment level. Okay. So this aggregation normally makes sense if you are like try to run aggregation across TIs or events are belong to different TIs. Okay, with the exception of only last value. This we are also right now, this is if you add this aggregation type, it will work in the application itself. Okay, because you may have like for example a program state that is repeatable, and if you only just want to show the last value, then you can have this selected here. All data elements are constants are supported, and as well as attributes, so there are no issues with that. The variables that are supported are this one that are marked. So basically we are not supporting some ones that are the unit count, the program stage ID, stage name, async date. This is not supported yet, but all the rest of them, yes. All functions and digital functions are supported now, with exception of relationship count. Okay. Again, as we are only centering in the enrollment domain, we still don't have a relationship that counts like different relationships between TIs. That's not here yet. And then also we are not supporting yet the period boundaries. That is not, the boundaries, we are not supporting this yet. Okay, so let's see how we have, let me navigate then to the indicators here. Maintenance is confusing with the. Okay. Really. Okay. Let's try again. One more time. It's not. Okay, I can't remember now my password.
Do you want mine?
Okay, here we are. Okay. So I'm going to the indicator part here. Program indicator. Okay, selecting the program. For instance, so this is the one that I we are using as an example. This is like evaluating the potential risk of having COVID of an individual. Okay, and then you see that it's important again is to have this here display inform. Okay, as we have this display inform, it will show up in the application. Okay, and also you see that we have this legend linked to the program indicator. Okay. And the expression, I mean, we don't have filters here, but we are like, of course, we are supporting any formula here. But you see that the expression, this expression is complicated. It takes into consideration like many values of different data elements. There are the two functions here as well, the two conditions. And basically this is evaluating from 1 to 3, the potential risk of a person to have COVID. One is the riskiest evaluation, and 3 is the lowest risk. Okay, so let's see how this is rendering in the application. Okay, so if I'm going like this program over here, No, this is data set, sorry. This one. Okay, so I think this one, for example, I can open this one. So now you see an indicator stuff over here, and you see that there is a result. Okay, it's one. Okay, so basically it's evaluating all the formula, and it, at the end it will show you like the red flag, a red color here, because this is based on the legend set. So it is red for one, yellow for two, and green for three. Okay. So yeah, the important takeaway here is that we support like a lot of formulas and functions, and there is even no limitations for if you want to write a complicated expression here. Okay, let's continue then with relationships. Okay, as you know, relationships has been completely revamped from 2.30, the 2.30 DHS 2 versions. Okay, and now we don't have limitations regarding the program that the TIs belong to, enrollment, the old units that they are enrolled, or the track entity type. Okay, it is important to mention that right now in the app we are only supporting relationships between track entity instances. You know that you don't have this limitation in the web. So if you go to maintenance, you can define like different relationship types between TIs and enrollments, between enrollments and events, between events and events, okay? But so far, we are going to have this functionality in that we have that in the roadmap, but so far it is only working between track entity instances. And again, these track entity instances can belong to the same or different programs, can be enrolled in the same or different or units, and can belong to the same or different track entity type. Okay, we are going to see an example about this in a moment. Okay, so this is how it's going to be rendering in the application. So we have the again, in the, this is in the context of the TI, of course, and we have the overview, the indicators and relationships, and all the relationships are going to be listed in this tab. Okay, so you click, basically you can navigate. In this case, Jaime Bosque has been in contact with José García Muñoz. If you click on this clip, then your app will navigate to the screen with information of the José García Muñoz dashboard, okay, with the enrollment that they have and so forth. And also, if you click on the cross, you can remove the relationship as well. Okay, so how this is going to be set up? How can this be set up in the web? So at the end, you have to go here to maintenance. Okay, so you go in program and then relationship type. Okay, we have different options here. I mean, different relationship types, but the one that we are going to use is this one, has been in contact with. Okay, and we mark this as a bidirectional because I am in contact with Marta. Also, Marta is in contact with me. So this means that in the app, you can navigate both sides. Okay, and then this may have some implications also for the analytics also in the web. Basically we have then, this is the important part in which we are defining the constraints. So here I'm saying that the left part of my relationship is going to be a track entity instances that from this track entity type that belongs to this, that can be enrolled in this program. Okay, and then the right is going to be the same, a track entity instance that is, which person, target type is person that is also enrolled in this program. Okay, so this is how we are like defining the relationships here, relationship types. But again, as I was saying, there is no constraint with the track entity type. So for example, maybe this is more important use case for malaria, but so we can have like other track entity type, which is an area, okay. That also can be, you can enroll areas in other programs, okay? Like for example, imagine that you can have like an area for COVID, like different COVID areas, okay? So then this means that, for example, you can define, let me see, it belongs to the area, okay? Imagine that you have the relationship type over here, okay? So basically it's the same, but in this case, the left part, the relationship name is bidirectional, but in this case, the relationship name from initiating entities contains, and from the right part is belongs. Okay. So then, in this case, the left part of the relationship is any TI which target ID type is an ARIA. Okay. And normally, we have this program for enrolling ARIAs in this particular program. But again, the red side is going to be persons and that are enrolled in this program. Okay. So basically, again, there are no limitations with the target ID type. Okay. I think that then is really powerful when we want to display this in maps, because you can display, like, then it's very powerful. You can display different things in maps. Okay, so let's see how then this is rendering in the application. So I'm going to go to the program now. This is going to be the COVID-19 and contact registration follow-up, this one. Okay, and then I can see the, for example, let's choose like Victor, for example. Okay, and if I, again, I have indicator, relationships. Now if I go to relationships, okay, I can see that Victor has in contact with these two persons. Okay, so I can just navigate, and for example, I can go to this person. I click on the click, and then I can navigate to that one. Okay, so let me go, and then I can open this enrollment, and I can see all the data that is has been recorded for Pablo Pajuelo. So I can, like, create any other relationship. In this case, for example, has been in contact with other person over here. And then the persons I need to specify, I can specify here, because this is all the person that I have in my device, stored in my device, regardless the program that they are enrolled to. So if I just want to use the same program, I can filter here. Okay, COVID-19 contact registration. Okay, and then I can, like, click, I can search. This is, for example, surname. And do a search over here if I want, okay? And then this will render in only, sorry. Okay, it will render only the person that I'm looking for. Okay, also, if you are online, this in theory should give you, like, the other TIs that has been enrolled in this particular program, but they are not being stored in your device, okay? So in this case, let's say that is Marta, so I click here. Okay, and then I have already added the relationship over here. Okay, so normally this is how it works. If I want to, for example, create a relationship between Victor Garcia, this person, and an area, I can check this belongs to the area, and you see that it is showing me the icon of that program. And then, I forgot to add here the display attributes. But then I only have one area, and then okay. Okay, well, there is we have a bug over there. So I don't know why this is not working now, but this in theory it will allow you also to create a relationship between Victor Garcia and that particular area. Okay. So then we can show the relationship in a map, but we are going to see that in a moment. So let's then move ahead with maps. Okay, maps. The maps that we can show in the application has been completely revamped from the two version. Okay, so now we can show we can visualize different coordinates in the application, in our application as well. So basically, we can manage and we can show in a map, like, the track entity instances, enrollments, events. Data element and attributes, you know that you can have, like, a data element and attributes which type is coordinate. So these ones we cannot have, then we don't have them yet in the application, but they are coming next in the next version into 4 that is going to be released in April 2021. And for their units, we don't have yet our units here, the coordinates of their units. Okay, we are not showing the coordinates of their units in our app yet. I think that we don't have, I'm not sure now if we have this in the roadmap, probably yes, but we don't have this certainly like target to any particular version. Okay. So this is going to be into 4 in next April, this we don't know yet. And then from the application, now we can like get, we can draw or ping points, select a point in the map and it will like, create a GPS point with latitude and longitude, but also you can draw polygons. Okay, polygons now from 2 to 2, I believe they are like represented in. You can create polygons in with the Android application as well. Okay, so how you define this in the server? So so there are like different possibilities. So if you would like to have this in the TI, you know that the TI, the target entity instances, they have enrolled, they have coordinates now. So basically in the target entity type, there is a new field that is feature type, okay? Then you can specify there if the value is non-value, because you are not interested in recording any GPS coordinate for the target entity type, or if it is a point or if it is a polygon, okay? And then in the enrollment process, then you will have, it will show up, and then we will see this in a moment. This will show up the data entry field for recording the latitude and the longitude. So you can click on a map. If you click here in this icon, it will show up a map, and you will have to select a position in a map. Or if you have the location activated in your device, then you can also create in this icon over here that it will give you the actual position of the user. Okay, this is one possibility. We also have the possibility of the defining the enrollments. Okay, you know that in the enrollments now there is an option for feature type as well. That again, you can select a point, you can select a polygon. So this is in Android right now. This have more or less the same meaning. Okay. So you may decide, okay, I just want to have target entity type GPS, or you may want to have like a enrollment point. This more or less having the same functionality. Okay, for me, the main consideration that you have here, that you need to have here in order to select one or the other, is then in the analytics. Okay, because then in the analytics or in the maps, that they are thrown in the server, then it will be different if you are selecting one or the other. Okay, but this is more server side, so I'm not going to talk about that. Then we can also collect GPS coordinates for events. In this case, again, now the program stages, they have like a feature type, and it can be a known point or polygon exactly the same way. So at the moment that you create a new event, if you select here a point, it will show up this field over here. Okay. Then I think also data element and attributes. We can like we are not displaying this in the map, okay, in an Android map, but certainly we can record coordinates in a data element or an attribute. Okay, just need to be of the coordinate type, and then we will record data elements. And then you can display those coordinates in the server. Not yet in Android, but in the server. And last one, we can have an origin unit attribute. Then it will display like if we have an origin unit attribute, it will display like a list like this, like a screenshot like this. In which this is Sierra Leone. I don't know if I can zoom in. No, I cannot. But basically, it will render all your search or unit tree if the user is using the linked the org unit tree an org unit from the search org unit tree, then it will render here like all the different levels of the org unit. So in this case it's Sierra Leone, and then you will have to select the different districts, the type room, but the different facilities here. Okay, for example, also you can do that here as well. So okay, let's have a look at the server. Okay, and so then we have, if I am navigating to the track entity type, I have this person as track entity person, track entity type, and then you see that the feature type is point. Okay, this means that they are for any APIs that belong to the person, I can like record a GPS point. If I'm looking, for example, to the area, okay, in this case, you see that the feature type is polygon. Okay, so then you if you are creating a new area, then you will have to record a polygon, an area. Okay, and then what else? If I'm going to the program, here this is the one, I believe. Okay, in the Roman details, you see that I don't have in the feature type, I have this as none. Okay, if I have, for example, this as point, then during the Roman, the Android application, it will ask me for two coordinates, one after the other. So I think it can create a lot of confusion to the users and probably doesn't make sense. So again, you have to select, our recommendation is to select one or the other, and then which one should you select? It depends on the analytics that we'll let you have in the server side. So in this case, I'm going to add their none value. And then the program stage, for example, the contact information, I believe this has coordinates as well. And you will see because, where is this one? I cannot see it. Description. Okay. The feature type here is point. Okay. So basically in this example, we can record coordinates from TIs and events. Okay, so how this is rendering in the application? So then let's, for example, I'm going to create a new person. Let me start. Press in. Okay, so John. Okay. Running today. Okay, this is enrollment. And you see here that I have this field now here that I can select or my current GPS coordinates, or I can select this in a map. So if I click on the map, then it's a matter of specifying a GP endpoint, a point here. Okay, accept. And reward the caller there. I mean, it's super simple. It's and the same with events. With events, we have the same options. So now you say, for example, delete and go back. I am not. If I want that, for example, to go and create like an area. Okay, so then let's say that this is rural. Okay, create a new one. Accept. Okay, and here I see that the coordinates for the area is a polygon type. Okay, so I have to click here in a map. Okay, and then I can specify any polygon just clicking in different parts of the map. Okay, like this. Okay, so it's the way that we are recording the different polygons for this particular use case. So let's move quickly. I'm not interested in this one. So to how, if I have, for example, open this one again. So now we have we have different views. This is the most common view in which you have all your TIs they are in a list. Okay, but as this TI is the track entity type has a polygon, so all these TIs belong are persons, and the track entity type has a point as the feature type. So then this menu show up here. So the condition for this is any of these TIs has a track entity type with that feature type as point or the enrollment. Okay, to condition. If you don't have that, this option never show up. Okay. So then I click on the show in a map. Okay, and I have the different TIs that have been recorded, and it will show in the case that we have this is the same as in the list. So in the list, as Marta was showing, it will show the picture of the TI in the case that you has an attribute which type is image, and then you have selected that you have marked as, that attribute as a displaying list. So in this case, it's the same. So we have all the, so let's go here where I'm living. Okay, so we have all the information, all the icons here linked to ATI. I can like navigate this using these cards over here, so I can move to different ones. Okay, and I can like select one, and then it's going to take me to the TI. So if I click, for example, in this one, it's going to take me to the TI. So basically, it's a way of rendering the TIs instead of a list like in a map. And again, I can do any kind of filtering here, I have the same options as I have in the list here, so I can do any filtering, okay? Or I can do any search, for example, Jose. Okay, so it will show where Jose is in a map. Okay, let me then have it as before. Okay, so then we have this map layer over here. This is, this represents the different layers that I can display in the map. So I have the TI coordinates. If I want, I can change to satellite view. So it will display in a satellite view. Okay. Yeah, and I think that is particularly interesting for, again, the malaria use cases, for the foci for malaria. Okay, but it's now, we have this possibility over here now. And now, well, we are not sure. Let me go back. Yes. Okay, here we go. We can also have the enrollment coordinates. Okay, in the case that we are collecting enrollment coordinates, as we are not collecting enrollment coordinates right now, so this is going to show nothing. Okay, contact information. We have also the possibility of as I said before, of also showing in a map the coordinates for an event. Okay, so if I just click select this one, so I deselect this and I click this one. Okay, I click on apply. And then this will show me, this is showing me like all the events where the events are happening. Okay, now. Okay, one use case that, for example, I like to, and not, I can navigate also the events as I did before with the TIs. Okay, and I can see, like, for example, this event belongs to this particular TI. So yeah, I think that there are a lot of possibilities here. So for example, one use case that I think is pretty interesting here is when you have like schedule events. So imagine that you may need to conduct an investigation in different areas of your city or in your villages. So basically you may have like all those investigations as an event that are scheduled. So then this is a way of navigating for the user of navigating in a map the different tasks, like because then they can see like when the event needs to happen and where it needs to happen. Okay, so I think that this one is quite interesting use case. And I think that this is all for maps. And well, last thing that I can mention is like, as I said before, relationships, you also can see relationships in the map, okay? And then, for example, we can like open, I don't know, like let's say Jaime Bosque. So I can go here, the relationships in a map. And then if I click here, okay, this is going to show me, like in this case, that the relationship that Jaime Bosque has with the different TIs, in this case is Marta, in this case, other person that is called Smith, okay, in a map, the relationships. And also, you see that Jaime has a relationship with the foci as well, sorry, with the area. Okay, so this is interesting because in the same app we can show TIs from different track entity type and relationship from different track entity types as well. Okay, we are combining all these together. And again, this is quite interesting malaria context for size areas and cases, positive cases. Okay, and I think I have 5 or 10 more minutes. So let's go to the next part of the presentation. That I think is the last one is the settings. Okay, all the synchronizations, how is the synchronization happens in Android application? So we can define, or the user can define, how the application synchronize with the server and other parameters in the setting part of the application. Or as probably most of you know now, there is also a web application that we call like the Android Settings app, in which you can define also the different synchronization process for your Android mobiles. Okay, so let's go first with what the Android user has here. Okay, so if you go to home and if you click on settings, okay, so these are all the options that we have. We can have we have the sync data, okay, with the different periods. Okay, the one that is the default, but we have all these options. Okay, and if you want to sync the data like manual, you can click here. So then it will sync all the data in both ways. The data that is in the server you don't have, and the data that has been collected in your device to the server. Okay, and then, but normally as the default, it is going to be scheduled one per day. So it's going to try to synchronize all your data one every 24 hours. The lowest value that we have for this is 30 minutes. There are some people that maybe, yes, I also would like to, okay, now we synchronize it, for example. Maybe I would like also to, we would like also to understand your use cases, because there are in some conversations with some HISP, they were saying that sometimes even 30 minutes is not quick enough. Okay. The problem with this, with having low values here, is like we need to be a bit worried with the server as well. So, you know, because anytime that you are synchronizing it with the server, it can create a performance stress with the server. So it's something to consider as well. Okay. So that is our recommendation. Having 30 minutes as the lowest value. Okay, but then it's something that we can discuss if we know better your use case. Maybe there is something, some workarounds that we can do. So this is for the data, for the metadata. We have here the syncing period. The default is 1 week. The 1 day also is the default, but it can be 1 week or manual process. So in manual, you click here, and then all the configuration, all the metadata for the programs and our units or data sets, it will be downloaded from the server. Syncing parameters, these are the number, as you know, this mobile application. So this has to be, of course, the database is very limited, the size of the application, because of the physical limitations, physical constraints. So these are the default parameters. So we are saying that anytime that a user synchronizes with the server, it will download a maximum of 1,000 events and 500 TIs. You can change this, okay, and put any value that you like. But again, be careful, because also it can be if your user doesn't have, for example, Wi-Fi, it can cost money for the user as well. It can create more stress to the server, and sometimes if you are downloading like 50,000 TIs, so that database size is not sometimes manageable. Okay. Also, these settings limited can be globally. So in this case, this will download 1,000 events, 500 TIs total. But then if you click, for example, by your organization unit, be careful with this, be careful, because this means that it will download 1,000 events, 500 TIs per unit. Okay, so if you have one more unit, it's okay. But if you have like 100 units, then it will download like 100 times 500 TIs. Okay, so that is the mathematical words, like 50,000 TIs. Okay, so careful with this combination of parameters here. And also by program, so then you will like the download 50 TIs per program, and then a combination of or unit and program. So there are a lot of flexibility here. So be super careful with your user and what you recommend to your user. Reserve values, we can define the reserve values here. How many, you know, that we can have an attribute that can have a pattern. And then like mix of, like sequential, random numbers, something like that. And this is, if we are going to work offline, then we should like create like a, we should storage like a several TI attribute values that are unique here. okay, in the local, okay, because we are not going to be able to continue asking the server for more values. So this is the number, how we are managing the numbers to be downloaded from the server, to be reserved from the server here. Okay, and then we can like select the refill if we want. Okay, we can like if there is one particular that the user needs to refill, whenever he or she has internet connection, he can click or she can click on refill, and they will like create an 100 more. Okay, these values also, you can configure these values with the value as you want. Okay, there are many considerations here, but I am running out of time. So maybe in the QA or also you have the documentation for this to check. OpenSync error logs, in which here we have, so you saw that we were having some issues with the server. So and here you have the error messages. Okay, that this basically is coming from the API. So sometimes this give us to the user some information, but many times it's like this kind of generic errors, 500 error that it doesn't, internal server error that doesn't give you more information. Okay, but sometimes it's quite useful as well. And then careful, of course, be careful of this, delete local data. I don't need to explain what this does, and reset up and data configuration. Okay, so with this, if you select this, you have a warning message over here, and be careful with this. Okay, and then last, we have the SMS settings over here that this will specify like an SMS gateway. So you have to configure a gateway between your devices and the DHS2 server. And then you can specify the number gateway here in these fields. Again, I'm not going to go to the details because this can be a long explanation, but this is the way that inside the application we have for configuring the gateways and how your device will communicate with the server which gateway. Okay, so all this configuration can be done as well using the Android Settings app. Okay. So all this configuration and much more, okay? Because also, we have now, like we have been using this application like in many implementations I think that the first version was rolled out in 3 years back, I think, or 2 years and a half. So basically we have experience like, one of the main takeaways is like, every implementation is different, right? So there are many that they want, okay, I want just for this particular program to download like maybe 400 TIs and only the TIs that has not been completed. But in other implementation, they would like to download like all the TIs that regardless the status, the enrollment status, completed or open. So this is very tricky, you know, to have like something that works well for everyone, okay? So the best way that we had in order to have a solution that can make happy everyone, we believe, is like having like a configuration application in the web. Okay. So then if you have a super user authority, you can then define what are the synchronization rules for all your Android users. Okay. So basically this application, let me go through this application. Let's see, access to app hub, I think this will appear here. Okay, you can download this application from here, from the app hub, okay? It's this one, the Android settings application, okay? And it's working for all the HS2 versions since 2.31, if I remember properly, okay? This is the first version. We're now working on the second version that with many improvements, okay, that's probably going to be like a rollout in April. So what this application does. So this is already installed. I'm not going to go through the process of install. And this is important. The only users that can have access to this application, okay, to change any configuration of this application, okay, are the ones who has the all authorities. Okay, we have done that because we believe that this really can have an impact of the way like all Android users are going to synchronize with the server. So certainly the only persons who should be able to define that configuration are the ones that are really administrators of the system. Okay, so anyone can see those values but only again, but only users which authority which are having the who are having the all authority can really change anything there. Okay. So let's see how. So this is the user. I am entering with the admin user that has the all authority here. So this is how it works. So I click on the. Okay, as this is the first time that I'm going to open the application because I recently installed the application. So it's going to warn me like, okay, if you are continued with this, then you are going to set up a configuration in the server, okay? That then all the applications, all the undercap applications will like download at the moment of synchronization, okay? So whatever you changes you make here, it will affect all the Android devices. Okay, so that's because we have this warning. Anyway, if we click on the cell set defaults and save, the parameters that we are going to have here are the same parameters, are the same default parameters as the application has. Okay, so I'm going to click set defaults and save. Okay, and what is important here that I forgot to mention is like if we have configured this in the server. Okay, the user cannot change anything in this in their settings. Okay, so basically this will block any changes in the application. Okay, so imagine that you have here like 20, how often should the metadata sync? Imagine that you have here like 1 week. And in the server, the Android user will like, no, I don't want 1 week, I just want 1 day. So it he or she cannot in the application. Okay. This needs to be managed by an administrator in the case that this configuration is happening in the server side. Okay, so basically many of the things that they were like showing up in the settings application in the settings menu, you have them here. Like how often should metadata sync? How often should they data sync? Okay, what are the SMS gateways? What are the reserved values per attribute? And you see that these are the default values that we already had in the application, but I can change here. So if I put here 500, then no one can change that in the application. It's going to be 500. Okay. And then one thing that is pretty important is the encrypt database. So we can also make like all the applications that are like all the Android applications that are always being encrypted. If you click set here, but again, this will have like an impact so we on your devices. So because this is not that you are encrypting like some users and others don't. No, this is all the users, all the Android users, all the users that are using an Android device, their database will be encrypted. Okay. So I think that this can be important for when we are like working on HIV context that you are having these options here. So you click on encrypt and then next time that you synchronize, that a user synchronize with the server, then it will encrypt their devices. Okay. Also important to mention. The only way of having this option is this option does not exist in the other application, only exists here, of course. Okay. And then I can like continue going to programs, and then in programs. Okay, again, how many you already have like this information as well in the settings part of the application of the Android application? How many TIs I want to download? This is new and any time period last month. So 500 TIs that has been enrolled in the last month or in the last 3 months or in the last 12 months. Okay, maximum events to download, and also can specify like the different value for the periods here. Okay, and sometimes because this happens to me also for some context, people instead of thinking like globally, okay, they just want to think in from program perspective because they may have, okay, I have, my users have like a program for HIV, a program for malaria, and they want different rules. I want like, for example, for malaria to download like 500 TIs, and I want for HIV to download 100 for any reason, right? So you can do that here as well. So you can select like, for example, a particular program, let's say this one, and then for this program, imagine that you want to be able to download 550. Click on save, and then maybe you have other program that can be I don't know this one that this is with events with no registration. Okay, let me then use other one like for example this one, and then for this you would like to just 400. Okay, so this is creating a configuration in the server that then next time that the application will synchronize with this configuration, then it will download, try to download a maximum of 550 for this program and a maximum of 400 for this particular program. Okay, then you click on save, you can edit these changes or remove them. Okay, so you can go to that. Okay, let me click on save. And data sets, more or less, is basically the same. There is a maximum of number of pairs to load for the data set, that which default value is 11. Okay, but then you may have like different data sets. In this case, we have two daily surveillance. So in this case, so there are defaults. So this application is like reading the, what is the period type for a particular data set. So for days, we have this default value of 59. Okay, you can change it, 65 if you like. Well, I don't know why it's. And then you have like the other data set that is weekly, that the default period, so it will download like 12 periods, the last 12 weeks, but then you can change it as well if you like. Okay, so that it will download the last 40 weeks. Okay, you can click here if you don't want to do this, you can reset all values to default, okay, if you like. And then one thing that I think is important as well for you to consider is like many times, people, they don't know how many, the configuration, they don't, it's related to what Marta was saying at the beginning. When you are like configuring an Android user, you need to be very careful with the amount of metadata and data that is going to be downloaded, okay? Because you can collapse the Android application, you can, if there are many Android users, you can collapse even the server. They are going to download, maybe the other day when we, with Bangladesh, we saw that they were using downloading like 150 megabytes, that is a lot, okay? So then we have this application, I mean, this option here, that in the case that you would like, for example, you entering a particular user, like let's say Jose, and then you would like to see, okay, how many, if this user is like logging with an Android device, how many data metadata is going to download? What is the size? Okay, so you just clean, run the test. Okay, and hopefully I can't remember how many units this user has. But then after a little bit, it will give you some results. Like it is downloading like a 5 units or 1 unit. Okay, so in this case it's done. So it's 2 units that is going to download, but also it's going to download like more than, I mean, 1,300 units for search. Data sets, one that are linked to the capture units, 15 program links to their units, 264 program rules. And then this is the size, okay? The size, we forgot to put here the I'm sorry for this, this has been corrected in the next version. We forgot to put here the what is the unity for the unit for the size. This is kilobytes, okay? So this means that for the metadata, we are downloading 2 megabytes, and for the data, we are downloading 232 kilobytes. Okay, so I really believe that this is, we really believe that this is very useful, because if you want to be sure that all the configurations that the user has is correct, just use this, okay? Because then if you can be problematic when users are downloading like hundreds of megabytes of data, as we have already seen in many places.